Well, hi, everyone. Let us situate ourselves by acknowledging the lands that we're on. I invite you to share in the chat where you are located and the names of the original inhabitants of that area. If you don't know the original inhabitants of the area you're in, please visit https://nativeland.california. I'm going to paste this into the chat so you can click on it. Okay. The Berkeley Public Library acknowledges that we sit on the unceded traditional lands of the Ohlone people. We honor with gratitude the land itself, as well as the Ohlone peoples who still live, work, and play in this region. The Berkeley Public Library condemns all forms of hatred, racism, and other forms of discrimination. We are outraged and saddened at the surge of hate crimes towards Asian American communities, as well as the racism that has been shown towards African American communities. We stand in solidarity with all marginalized groups that have been subjected to hatred and intolerance, and celebrate the differences that contribute to the strength of our community. Everyone is welcome here at the Berkeley Public Library. My name is Perlita Payne, and I'm a librarian here at the Berkeley Public Library. It's my great honor to welcome you all to our program this afternoon, where Monica Campbell will be talking to Terry Green Sterling and Jude Joff Block about their new book, Driving While Brown. This event is generously funded by the Friends of the Berkeley Public Library. Please feel free to type your questions for our presenters into the chat box at any time. Monica Campbell is a senior editor and reporter at The World, focusing on immigration and immigrant life. She served on the Committee to Protect Journalists and is a member of the National Association of Hispanic Journalists. She is based in the Bay Area. Terry Green Sterling is editor at large for the Arizona Center of Investigative Reporting and a three-time Arizona Journalist of the Year who teaches at the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at ASU. She authored a previous book, Illegal. Jude Joff Block joined the Associated Press as a reporter and editor in 2020. She has reported on immigration for more than a decade for outlets that include NPR and The Guardian. She grew up in Berkeley. So I'm going to turn it over to Terry and Jude, who will do a short presentation before your conversation with Monica. Let's welcome Jude and Terry.
Great. So I'm going to share my screen here. Thank you so much, Perlita. We're very happy to be here. And I'm going to show you, make sure that you guys can see this. Are we looking good? Okay, great.
Hi there. My name is Terry Green Sterling, and I'm so glad to be with you tonight. I was born into a borderlands family from Arizona and Sonora borderlands, and I've long written about the people, places, and politics of this region. I have interviewed and written about Arizona's notorious Sheriff Joe Arpaio for many years, for newspapers and magazines, for a previous book, and now for this book. I am most happy to share my insights and my experiences based on these years of reporting.
Hello, I'm Jude Joffe Block. Oops. Sometimes the presentation gets away from me. Sorry about that. I started covering former Sheriff Joe Arpaio back in 2012. At that time, I was a public radio reporter, and our book draws on about 30 interviews that we did with him over the years, as well as interviews with 100 other people who either opposed him, supported him, or factored into the story in some way or another. And as a journalist, I won't be sharing my opinion today, just my reporting and analysis. And we have a brief multimedia presentation to introduce you to the book before we're in conversation with Monica Campbell.
So this is a book about a powerful Arizona sheriff known throughout the world for his immigration crackdowns. Because he's known to retaliate against his critics and his foes, few in Arizona have the courage to stand up against him. So checks and balances break down in Arizona. but a really fearless Latino resistance rises up against Arpaio and the new laws in Arizona that are designed to criminalize and deport undocumented immigrants. On one level, this is a book about what it takes to fight unconstitutional policing and battle for American identity in a time of demographic change.
And we titled our book Driving While Brown because of the history of people of Mexican descent in Arizona feeling targeted by immigration-themed traffic stops long before Arpaio became sheriff. And Daniel Ortega, who was born in this country, was a young man in the 1970s when the Peoria Police Department began targeting farm workers and traffic stops to check their papers. Let's take a listen.
People were being stopped because they were brown, driving while brown, okay? And so we saw this not only as an attack on the undocumented community, but we saw it as an attack on us simply because of the features of our skin and our hair color and our language.
This is a book that sort of focuses in part on Joe Arpaio, who is the son of an unwanted immigrant who becomes the bane of unwanted immigrants. He spends 20 years in federal drug enforcement, where he develops several traits that will inform his tenure as Maricopa County Sheriff. They include a love for getting in the media, a fondness for conspiracy theories, and a knack for assuming the role of fictitious characters during undercover drug enforcement work. Arpaio retires in Phoenix and is elected sheriff in 1992. He creates a new persona for himself in this office, America's toughest sheriff. In the early 2000s, a movement builds in Arizona to restrict and punish unauthorized immigration from Mexico and Central America. Arpaio does not initially embrace this cause, but he pivots in 2006 after he sees it as popular with his voter base.
And in 2007, he signs up for a federal partnership to enforce immigration laws. And in the past, only federal agents could arrest immigrants for being undocumented, which is technically a civil violation, not a criminal one. But Arpaio sought to change that. This is a press conference in 2007.
My program, my philosophy is a pure program. You go after illegals. I'm not afraid to say that. Then you go after them and you lock them up.
Arpaio also raided work sites and arrested undocumented workers charged with felonies for working without authorization in the United States. And he started massive neighborhood sweeps. His deputies pulled over cars for minor traffic violations like cracked windshields, broken taillights, and suspected undocumented immigrants were turned over to ICE. And Latino drivers and passengers felt that they too were being targeted. And this is a short clip from a documentary, Two Americans, which we really recommend you watch. And it shows footage from those neighborhood sweeps. And it also shows some of the activists who are featured in the book who rushed to the scene to protest and try to help the arrestees.
Solamente su nombre, no coopere, no coopere. Es solamente su nombre, tiene el derecho a un abogado.
I mean, there was no reason to pull me over at all. There was no reason. I wasn't a speed, I didn't do any violation. I think it's the way I look Hispanic, and I am Hispanic.
Joven, tiene el derecho a un abogado. No sea intimidado. Le van a preguntar por dónde entró, con quién entró, en dónde vive, dónde está su esposa. No conteste.
You stop cars for having broken windshields and burnt out taillights. Explain how that is law enforcement. Explain that, Arpaio. Explain how that makes you a tough sheriff in America.
We are under attack.
No firmas! No firmas! No firmas!
Eso es lo que quiero que sepan.
Yo
a todas las familias que se cuiden porque esto parece un infierno. Arizona se está convirtiendo en un infierno para los hispanos.
Los van a querer intimidar. Los van a querer intimidar. Pidan por un abogado.
Sorry about that.
So who is in this resistance to the terror that you just saw? People who are indigenous, immigrant day laborers, Mexican Americans, older Chicanos, children of immigrants, young Latinx activists, and their allies, all of them join the resistance to Arpaio. We can talk about individual activists in more detail later, but right now, excuse me, I wanted to introduce you to Carlos Garcia, who grew up undocumented in the United States. This experience shaped his activism, and he spends every single day trying to figure out how to stop Arpaio. And this is Lydia Guzman, who loses her home and her husband to her activism.
One tactic the movement against Arpaio uses is to sue him in court for racial profiling. And activists like Lydia Guzman help collect evidence and find plaintiffs. And in 2012, this case goes to trial.
So Arpaio presents himself as a tired, confused old man at the trial, and he denies wrongdoing.
But a federal judge finds Arpaio's tactics unconstitutional, and he orders sweeping reforms to prevent profiling. He permanently bars Arpaio from arresting immigrants who have not committed any crimes. And later, the judge learns Arpaio ignored court orders. And members of the resistance push for Arpaio to be punished and prosecuted for criminal contempt of court. This is activist Viridiana Hernandez, a dreamer, in 2016. Oops. Back. Hear from her.
Arrest Arpaio. He has done enough crime. He has done enough suffering. He has done enough pain, and our community will not take it anymore.
So in the 2016 presidential race, Arpaio endorses Donald Trump. Activists see the striking similarity between Donald Trump and Arpaio, and they call Donald Trump the national Arpaio.
And meanwhile, many of the activists who'd been battling Arpaio for years launch a campaign called Basta Arpaio to get him out of office. And they mobilize voters of color who did not have a history of voting.
So after 24 years in office, Arpaio loses his reelection bid for sheriff in 2016. And after a criminal trial, Arpaio is found guilty of criminal contempt of court. Before he's sentenced, Trump rescues Arpaio with his first presidential pardon.
And Arpaio later tries running for office again, but he's not successful. And meanwhile, the grassroots effort to mobilize voters of color in Arizona continues. This is Maria Castro, who had walked neighborhoods to get out the vote since she was a high schooler in 2011. And she told us in 2020, she'd never seen voters as excited to participate as that year. And that excitement is one reason Arizona turned blue in the 2020 presidential election. I think the defeat of Joe Arpaio made it tangible that we can defeat the villains that haunt our dreams. That's what Maria Castro told us after her experience canvassing in 2020. And that concludes our presentation. So I'm going to stop sharing. Hopefully I'm back.
Hi, I'm going to jump in again. Thank you so much for everyone who is here and attending and jumping into the room. I'm really, really honored that Jude and Terry asked me to moderate this discussion. It's an incredibly important book. Please check it out, buy it or check it out. I think it's an incredibly important and relevant book to read at any time, but particularly now as we are continuing as a country to debate and weigh immigration policy in our country. And as the United States goes, often we see it influences other countries around the world. Once again, my name is Monica Campbell. I report on immigration for the world, which airs on KQED here, folks. It's always nice to speak to a Bay Area audience, but I know there's folks from different parts of the country, so welcome. Terry and Jude, my first question is, where did you come together to write this story? What brought both of you to decide to invest years into this subject matter? What brought you together?
Well, it's a wonderful story. I had been covering our pile for quite some time, and in 2012 or 2011, I had shopped a book proposal around New York and was flatly rejected by everyone. I was told this was not a national story, it was hyper-local. And so later on, I was covering the racial profiling trial, the unconstitutional policing trial, and I met Jude. And she said, wouldn't this make a good book? And Jude was the only person on the face of the earth who had ever said that to me. And we immediately bonded, and we collaborated, and we decided to collaborate on this book, but we didn't really sign the contract until 2016, a few years later.
And for me, I was covering this case for public radio, sometimes with Monica's help for the world. But there was still this frustration that these 4 minute, 5 minute snippets couldn't do justice to all of the historical context, the personal stories, the trauma, the pain, the sacrifice that went into the story. And so it just felt like, that's why a book felt so important, to try to really zoom out and explain how this landmark court case fit into this bigger story of the Mexican-American experience in Arizona and the country's immigration battles.
And so thank you for that. For those who may not know that much about Joe Arpaio, beyond some of the headlines when he became more nationally prominent and powerful, what's the best point of departure for understanding Arpaio as a person, where his political formation came from before he became such a national figure?
I think the best way to start is at the very beginning, with his father, who was an unwanted Southern Italian immigrant who barely made it into the United States at a time when the eugenics movement was governing immigration policy and had a strong influence on that. Southern Italian immigrants were considered very much in the same vein as Latino immigrants are considered today. Arpaio was taunted as the son of an immigrant, and he heard many of the same taunts that his followers now use today against Latino immigrants. He joined the DEA and disappointed his father because his father wanted him to go to college and he didn't. And in the DEA, he developed several skill sets, I guess you could call them, that would inform his tenure later on as sheriff. The first is he developed an understanding of how to charge on conspiracies and a love of conspiracy theories. The second is he learned how to jump into fictitious personas for undercover work, larger than life personas, right? And the third is that he developed a love for the media. After his DEA work, he then retired in Phoenix and he was elected sheriff in 1992.
And just to note, he was 60 years old.
He was 60 years old, yes.
So second career, so to speak.
Second career.
And in terms of when he first became sheriff, can you just kind of paint where he started that path?
Well, when he ran for sheriff, it was interesting. He actually said that he was only going to run for one term, which he ended up being the longest serving sheriff in Maricopa County history once he hit the 22-year mark. And when he was finally voted out, it was after 24 years. So he reneged on that promise. He built a brand quickly as America's toughest sheriff, being tough on jail inmates, making them wear pink underwear, making them sleep outside in tents. often doing news stories about how awful the jail food was. And so really, you know, he became a national household name. He started getting national attention for this brand, which sold well at the time, given the politics around crime at the time. There was a certain demographic that really responded well to this. And he became one of the most popular politicians in Arizona. I mean, his rankings were routinely the most popular and whenever there would be polling. There was often speculation if he would run for governor or other things. When politicians ran for office, they would kiss his ring, presidential candidates included. But what he didn't run on was immigration. And that did not really enter his radar until really halfway through his tenure. And as we show in the book, there were events leading up to it where it became clear that an important part of his base really demanded attention on immigration, that there was a shift happening among the Republican Party in Arizona that was very focused and concerned about the border and illegal immigration, and other politicians were gaining a lot of attention and popularity on this issue. And Arpaio found himself on the wrong side of this issue in the summer of 2005 in a number of high profile events, and kind of felt the wrath and the blowback of people who would later become his you know, most staunch base supporters, who felt he wasn't tough enough on immigration. And then when Arizona started passing state laws, the first one being a law that would criminalize smuggling people into the state, he pivoted to become the most enthusiastic enforcer of that law. And really, it took off from there.
So at the same time, you saw immigrant rights movements and Latino-led movements and other immigrant communities leading movements, highlighting the other side of that enforcement. So can you talk a little bit about who was countering Arpaio? Because one of the main folks in your books is also Lydia Guzman, who came from California, and I believe she might even be with us here in the audience, but that Lydia arrived to Arizona. And just speak a little bit about the forces at play on the other end of those who were countering the type of enforcement policies that Arpaio was proposing and implementing.
Well, I just want to invite Lydia to turn her camera on if she would like to say hello. This is our first event that we've been lucky enough to be joined by her.
Great.
So if Lydia, if you would like to talk, not to put you on the spot.
Yeah, you know, I just stepped out of the pool, so I'm not camera ready. Yeah, but
No worries. There's maybe during Q&A, but no pressure at all.
I'm just very, very pleased that this story was told. And I'm so glad that we have such excellent folks to document everything, to tell this story, because it's such an important story of how a community can organize and defeat bad. So thank you. And I'll just, you know, leave the discussion for Terry and Jude and Monica. Thank you for inviting us.
Thank you, Lydia.
Well, and we are informed by many hours of conversation with Lydia that she very generously gave us. So we can tell you a little bit about Lydia's background after all that time we spent together, which there was a key meeting in 2006 where all the immigrant rights activists in Phoenix got together and started a coalition, which later became the Coalition to Defeat Arpaio. But it started as a movement that people in Berkeley will remember as well, the massive immigrant rights marches of 2006. And that really launched, because that was happening nationally, and those marches to try to oppose federal legislation at the time. That same group that got together to organize marches, they called themselves Somos America in Phoenix. They became that organization. Those weekly meetings that they had also served as infrastructure for activists like Lydia and her colleagues to oppose Arpaio. And you asked a little bit about Lydia's background, and there is another California connection, because Lydia was born in Southern California and raised there. And some people in the audience will remember Proposition 187, which was a ballot initiative in 1994. Lydia was in her 20s at the time, and this initiative voters approved it. overwhelmingly. And the initiative was to try to restrict public benefits from undocumented immigrants, including access to non-emergency healthcare and access to public schools, including other benefits. And to Lydia and many others, it felt like an attack on the entire Latino community, not just the undocumented community. And it inspired Lydia and others to start to register voters to vote against such kinds of politicians. At the time, Pete Wilson, who was governor, was championing this initiative. And it inspired a political backlash. Lydia was involved in naturalizing new citizens to become voters. And ultimately, California changed demographics and its electorate changed. And many analysts credit the backlash to Prop 187 as having a fundamental part of that change in the politics of California. And Lydia moved to Arizona in the late 1990s and brought with her that what she had experienced in California, but also what the lessons learned from the California experience, and got very involved in the voter outreach part in Arizona with the hopes of a similar transition happening in Arizona. And it took a very long time, and we can talk more about this, but there are signs recently that things are starting to more look like the California model than ever before in Arizona.
And just to jump in on, so where did you see the support for Arpaio most in Arizona? I mean, Maricopa County, obviously, but can you just speak a little bit more broadly about the state and even nationally? You know, where was support for his campaigns coming in, even from outside Arizona? Yeah, what were some of the forces at play there?
Well, I mean, Arpaio first gained national fame for what many, many people view as utter humiliation and degradation of his jailhouse inmates. And he assumed the persona of America's toughest sheriff. And that formed the foundation for his national base of fans. When he ran for sheriff in Arizona, he ran as a tough on crime guy. And he was famous for making inmates wear pink underwear and sleep in tents and eat this tasteless, gloppy food and charging them a small fortune for condiments and things like that. So he had this base built in, and it was a conservative kind of white base. And then when he pivoted to immigration reform, he developed this kind of working class base of fans, gun rights guys, anti-Obama guys and gals who would send him totals of millions of dollars, but they would send it in $5 and $10 donations. And that was the support he used to get funding for his elections in Maricopa County as his popularity began waning in Maricopa County.
And just to underscore that, yeah, this was a national fan base. And, you know, there would be times, I mean, when he ran in 2016, there was this grassroots effort organizing against him on the ground, but he raked in $13 million for a local sheriff's race because of his fame and popularity all over the country.
Right. And in $5 and $10 and $15 donations.
Wow! I didn't realize that those were such small donations.
I mean, there were some big ones, but mostly small.
Right. But to have that kind of grassroots element to it. So Arpaio faced numerous civil rights lawsuits over his tenure, right? But the most prominent case involved racial profiling. Can you just give us an example of that case? I mean, you went over it a little bit in the presentation, but I just want you to paint a picture of what it meant to be racially profiled. Driving Will Brown is the title of your book. Can you give us an idea of what was at the crux of that court case?
Yeah, I think we could give the example of the original plaintiff who had entered the US legally as a Mexican tourist and had his tourist visa on his person. But at the time, the sheriff's office in 2007, when his traffic stop occurred, so in 2007, when Arpaio's office had new federal powers to arrest undocumented immigrants, one of the first communities that they targeted were day laborers. And I think that there was a sense that day labor equaled undocumented, and that this, and there were all kinds of citizens' complaints as well coming in. Another thing Arpaio did was open a hotline, and people would call in to complain, often about day laborers standing on certain street corners or in parking lots. And the allegation was always that, with the idea that all of them must be undocumented, and now therefore they could be arrested, even if there was no crime that had taken place. And so Arpaio's deputies started sting operations that targeted day laborers with the idea that they would follow drivers who were picking up day laborers for work, and then follow that car and wait for some kind of traffic violation, and then pull that car over and ask the people who had the passengers about their immigration status. And this is a pretty blatant form of racial profiling, because it was really based on the appearance of people who looked like day laborers and the supposition that that meant that they were undocumented. And at the time, so for example, the lead plaintiff in the case, Manuel de Jesus Ortega Melendrez, as I'd mentioned, he came into this country with a tourist visa, valid tourist visa, and he was stopped in one of these sting operations. The driver, who was white, was allowed to leave the scene. Ortega Melendrez was booked into custody, held for many hours in jail custody, and then transferred to ICE. Eventually, a federal immigration officer determined his visa was valid and allowed him to leave. But there was a severe trauma that Mr. Ortega Melendrez went through just from having that happen. And he felt it undermined his idea of what it meant to be in this country. He thought law enforcement were law-abiding and treated people equally. That changed his view of the United States, but it also, it changed him. He lost patches of his hair. He had panic attacks when he would see sheriff's deputies on the streets. He told us times where he felt paranoid when helicopters were overhead. And so I think that, you know, as a country, we're talking about what happens when there is discriminatory policing, and when some outcomes, we're talking about how Black Americans are killed by police officers. And I think it's also worth mentioning that even a traffic stop where maybe there's not even a physical injury can also be an incredibly traumatic experience for people if they feel like they've been targeted, if they feel like their rights have been violated in that process.
Right, and tell us, I know it's complicated and it even brings us more to present day, but where that court case ended, or what is the current state of that?
Yeah, the case is still going. It is now called, wow, it's named after the man we mentioned. It's called it was called Melendrez v. Arpaio. It was filed in 2007. It is now 2021. The case still exists. It is now called Melendrez v. Penzone for the new sheriff that replaced Arpaio. And interestingly, it has taken many twists and turns. And the most recent is that the new sheriff is also has yet to get into compliance with the court's orders. Basically, the case will be under court authority for until their compliance with all the court orders are met for 3 years. And then there's an independent monitoring team in place. This case is projected to cost taxpayers upwards of $200 million by 2022. And so it's been phenomenally expensive. It's taken a lot of resources, and it's not over. And in fact, the new sheriff has fallen into trouble with the same judge for also not being in compliance and not following all of the court's guidance. So it just shows how difficult legal remedies can be, even when they're sweeping and even when there's a grassroots effort to organize on this level and get plaintiffs and even win. This is what victory looks like. It's years and years, and it's expensive and it's slow and it's complicated. And still the most recent reports that analyze what kinds of experience Latino drivers have in Maricopa County show that there are still disparate outcomes for Latino drivers, even with all of this court-ordered reform.
Yeah,
go ahead, Terry.
Oh, I just wanted to quickly add the whole purpose of the Melendres case was not to secure monetary damages for the plaintiffs. Instead, it was to clean up the culture in this, you know, this agency that was found to, by the judge, to have engaged in discriminatory policing. And this new sheriff said he was going to comply, but now the judge is angry because the new sheriff has not, his team has not investigated over 1,000 complaints about what's going on in the sheriff's office. So it's a long deal. I mean, these class action civil rights cases drag on for years and years as they try to clean up the police departments.
And I think it also illustrates, you know, you mentioned this, Jude, you know, what does victory look like? And I'd love to ask you both, researching this chapter of our history so deeply, what have you come away with in terms of looking at social movements and the resistance to Joe Arpaio? And how did you see strategies differ among the Latino community and the immigrant rights community? Where did you see tension? Where did you see hard discussions among groups about what victory looks like and what strategies to adopt for the change that people wanted? I'd love just to hear where that tension lies.
Yeah, I mean, so I think that one of the key fissures that we outline in the book is that this movement, like so many others, brought together people who all wanted to stop Arpaio, and they wanted to stop this kind of policing, and they wanted to save immigrant families from being torn apart. I'd say that they shared many of the same goals, but that when it came to what strategies to employ, really the movement as a whole did things like basically like four prongs, which was mobilizing voters to change the electorate and change who was in office. This racial profiling lawsuit, getting involved in the courts, organizing, getting plaintiffs, getting lawyers involved. And then really a battle in the public square to kind of in the sort of marketplace of ideas, getting the story out, sharing narratives with media and having a different side of the story told. And then also like protests, civil disobedience. And I'd say that different activists gravitated towards different elements of that strategy. And then one of the key tension points was who to work with and whether to build broad coalitions. So Lydia Guzman, for example, worked closely with the business community, with one businessman in particular, who actually secretly funded her work running a hotline, as well as the lawsuit. There was such fear of retaliation at the time that he only revealed his role in our book for the first time. He had kept himself anonymous or kept that information under wraps up until our book. So working with the business community who shared an interest, because he ran several fast food franchises and worried about his workers and worried about the ability to do business in Arizona with such kinds of policies. And then there were others who wouldn't, and also the idea of working with the Democratic Party, trying to get Democrats elected, trying to invest hope in Democrats passing immigration reform. And then there were other activists like Carlos Garcia, who we showed in the slideshow, who took much more of an approach that really, if we're going, like, we have to help ourselves, like the undocumented community and its allies really have to win these battles and think carefully about who we're going to trust, because at the end of the day, our interests might not always align. So we have to be careful about those alliances. And so Carlos had noticed that the judiciary did not always rule in ways that were what he wanted. He noticed that the Democratic Party seemed to talk out of both sides when it came to immigration enforcement. And so he was much more interested in trying to empower the immigrant community to try to help themselves, to use civil disobedience to get out the story to the media and protest and use that as a tactic. And so really sort of an inside versus outside strategy. And what we show in the book is that basically this movement involved all of these different strategies, but they really kind of all came together towards the same goal.
Go ahead, Terry.
Oh, I just wanted to jump in and say historically, since the end of the Mexican-American War in Arizona, Mexican-American citizens and Mexican immigrants have always been lumped into one category, Mexicans, and have been treated as such, have been segregated together, have been sent to poor schools together, have been deprived of opportunities together. And we have many families that are mixed status families in which there are undocumented immigrants as well as American citizens. So for all these reasons, many members of the resistance took this very personally and believed that Arpaio's discriminatory policing and the Arizona laws meant to criminalize and deport immigrants were not only targeting immigrants, but they were also targeting Mexican-American citizens. So that fueled their passion. And the other thing that I quickly wanted to say is that these civil rights battles might be brought on by one community, but in the end, they benefit every American. So they were not only fighting and sacrificing and losing and winning for their community, but for each of us in America so that our civil rights can be strengthened.
And I wanted just to answer, Monica, you brought up the idea of what is victory after a battle like this. And you know, I think that again, there's very different answers to that depending who you ask in this movement. And there were people who felt like Penzón beating Arpaio and becoming the sheriff was a victory. And there are others who feel discouraged by this new sheriff who, because ICE and federal immigration officers still pick up people who are arrested at the Fourth Avenue Jail in Maricopa County, people who are arrested. There's still a direct connection between being arrested at the jail and potentially ending up in ICE custody. And for many in the movement, one goal was to interrupt that connection, that nexus between local law enforcement and federal immigration enforcement and deportation. And because that nexus still exists, there's people who feel like the battle is still not won. Even though Penzón will not put out press releases or have major events talking about immigration, it's a much quieter kind of approach. It's one that is quite common all across America. Places like the Bay Area, it's been something that's high profile and discussed and debated, and some counties and local jurisdictions have tried to end those relationships. So I think there are always still more battles ahead, and each individual is going to define sort of when that victory is reached. In Arizona, Lydia Guzman is working on redistricting as her next thing that she's passionate about. And there is a lot happening in Arizona around voting, as you've probably heard, and the future of elections in Arizona. And a lot of the activists that we write about and some of the organizations have gotten involved in that fight as well.
Yeah. Let me just, before we jump into questions, I do want to get in, while Arpaio was facing the racial profiling court case, he presented himself as a victim. And I want to hear a little bit about that. And I also want to hear, where is there still strong support for Arpaio and those who, were standing by him all along? Because we know he's a polarizing figure, but he also represents, we saw, obviously, Trump get elected. There was a symbiotic relationship between Trump and Arpaio. But it's important to hear how he was framed in his narrative, how he framed that, and how it's still supported in Arizona today by certain population, right? Certain communities.
Yeah. I mean, exactly right. Arpaio, especially during the contempt, when he was being prosecuted for criminal contempt of court for violating court orders, because that started under the Obama administration, he saw that as a political vendetta by the Obama administration. He had been publicly feuding with Obama on immigration matters, but also don't forget he was one of the people promoting the false theory that Obama's birth certificate was not real. And so this was this somebody he had been sparring with for years. And so he turned this contempt case, which began under Obama's Justice Department, as a political vendetta, a witch hunt against him, a way to take him down. And I think many of his supporters also saw it that way. They saw this, they believed this federal judge was way out of line, and the judge was the one who was unfair and violating Arpaio's rights. We have seen that while Arpaio still has some loyal support, in fact, it's his birthday today, and I received a press release about a large birthday event he's having. He's still being asked for political endorsements by certain people. But he did try running for office again, and it did not work. He's turning 89 today. And so, you know, that is an advanced age to be running for office. But I think that many of the people who supported Trump, and there are many, like many things about Arpaio as well. And there's a lot of overlap between their two bases.
I think really quickly that he created, you know, he created a conspiracy theory in which he became the victim of, you know, as Jude said, of these massive powers that he could not fight. He fought to the end, but he could fight them no more. And he went down a hero. And, you know, the usual players, you know, George Soros and Obama holdovers all conspired against him. So that's how he plays what happened to him in his mind. And I think he's pretty marginalized. He's selling his autographs now online for $19.
Interesting.
And, yeah. And he goes to these really fringe events. But I think his most of his supporters have pivoted to more interesting things, like the Maricopa County voter count. And
let's jump in on that, because that's one of the questions we have. Can you just explain, give us a little bit of context about this audit, what's going on with the election and the count? And is there any connection with Arpaio's supporters? Is there anything, you know, how can we relate his legacy to what's happening today, if that is possible?
Well, his legacy of conspiracy theories and of conspiracy theories are alive and well. He and Trump shared a love for those. But the Maricopa County, for those of you who don't know, is the most populous county in Arizona, and it's the Phoenix suburban area. And Trump lost by a tight margin in Maricopa County. And the Arizona legislature is extremely red. Both the House and the Senate in Arizona are red. And there are many, many, many Trump loyalists in the Arizona legislature. So they came up with this Maricopa County. The state Senate mandated this ballot count, which is run by a very inexperienced company. And many critics view it as just a way to discredit, you know, a free election system in the United States and to cast doubt on it with conspiracy theories. But I've seen a few in the crowds outside protesting. I've seen a few old Arpaio fans. And this is exactly the kind of thing that they would gravitate to. They also gravitated to, as I mentioned, they fought Obamacare and they supported Trump. And, you know, I think Arpaio is pretty marginalized at this point. He's 89. And yeah.
And just to add to that, though, but to zoom out a bit, I mean, I do think it's interesting that this is the county where this is playing out, because I think that Maricopa County has this history of having some of the most sort of extreme actors, but also being a microcosm of certain elements of the United States, and showing in a way some of the most kind of lightning rod issues in stark relief. You know, that Arizona and Maricopa County played that role in the immigration debate, and now are sort of out ahead with this kind of unprecedented informal audit that other states are also looking at doing. And so it's playing a similar role, and it's also causing rifts within the Arizona Republican Party that we've seen before in the immigration context. And so when our
in terms of law enforcement and immigration enforcement, I think
Arizona Republicans have been split on immigration matters in the past, and now we're seeing this split happening over the audit, where some Republicans are saying, look, there was no fraud, we need to accept this and move on, and others are saying there was a conspiracy or there was fraud and we need to see what's happening with this audit. And there's tension that's playing out within that sort of that far right base that's concerned about the election with some of the more establishment Republicans. And that's that tension we saw, for example, with John McCain and Senator Flake were trying to play that moderate role with in immigration. And then we're really, we saw Flake not be able to maintain being a senator in Arizona because his party had moved so far to the right. So this divide of among Arizona Republicans, I think between a very far right place and what had been historically a conservative place, but now is being considered moderate. I think that we're seeing echoes of this now in this audit. And also in the Arpaio era, there was a lot of tension between in county government, a lot of fractured response to how to deal with Arpaio and how to proceed. And I mean, you're seeing here in Maricopa County today, like the recorder and the county supervisors are very much opposed to this audit and are kind of in a battle with the state Senate over how to proceed. And these are all Republican lawmakers who are having a bit of a civil war here.
And I just want to jump in because we, to get to a couple of our questions, we don't have that much time left. But as you can see, one of the questions is for you, Terry, from Constantino Lopez.
Okay.
Constantino writes, I was part of SOMOS and I have read your book, Illegal, your first book, right? And he says, thank you for documenting such important history. It sounds like he wants a little bit more context for how Arpaio became involved with immigration issues. And you both spoke about how the day laborer movement really became like a visible part of demographic change, but also labor movements and different types of visibility when it came to immigrant life in the United States. But was there anything else there that you'd want to add, Terry, to address Constantino's question?
Okay. Hi, Constantino. It's nice to see you over the e-waves. So Arpaio is a very, I think at the root of this question is, the answer is that Arpaio is a very, very needy man. And he sort of identifies himself, in my opinion, by what he reads about himself in the media. He craves media attention. And when he read in newspapers that he stopped a guy at a highway rest stop who was holding migrants at gunpoint, and he arrested the guy, and he said,
well, his deputy did.
His deputy, right, but his agency.
Yeah.
Right. And they arrested the guy. And there was an immediate backlash by many white voters who were very upset about immigration. And when Arpaio saw the backlash and the letters to the editor in the press, and he saw also that the county attorney, who immediately heroized the guy who had stopped the migrants at gunpoint, when Arpaio saw these things happening, he pivoted because he saw that it was popular with his base to be a very restrictive immigration enforcer. So that's what he did. And you wanted very quickly to talk about the partnership sort of with Andrew Thomas. Andrew Thomas was a young county attorney who campaigned on an anti-immigrant platform, and he and Arpaio worked in tandem for quite a while. One of the things that they devised was this sort of way to charge migrants on a who were being transported across Arizona by coyotes. They charged the migrants for conspiracy to smuggle themselves through Arizona. And these were the sorts of things in which they had the symbiotic relationship. Arpaio did the arrests, Thomas did the prosecutions. Ultimately, Thomas was disbarred and no longer lives in the state.
Thank you for that. And I have a question, just very briefly, kind of a media question I have to ask. At the time, Arpaio, and then we're going to wrap up in a couple of minutes, but when Arpaio was kind of at its height and most had, you know, the most political support, how did you see the media framing of him, either done well or in a way that was problematically? And I just ask that because we see these polarizing figures reported on. There are a lot of tropes and fixed narratives that can get set. And I just would love to hear kind of what tips you would give for our audience when it comes to these stories where we see a very polarizing figure. We can see this, for example, with the governor of Texas today, or Trump in his time, or Arpaio in his time. What do you watch out for when it comes to reading about polarizing figures like Arpaio, and particularly when it comes within the context of immigrant life and, you know, the debate over immigration policy in the United States?
I think it's such an excellent question. And I think that, you know, one of the people that we talked to for this book, the way that they described it, one of the immigrant rights activists, felt like the local media had lost track of, sort of in the rush to do both sides journalism. Arpaio says he's doing this and activists say they oppose it, that the middle was shifting, and that really the context that what Arpaio was doing was unprecedented, was stripped out of a lot of the stories. You know, this idea that you have an elected law enforcement official and when he makes news, he will always make news as an elected official. But there are not only two sides to stories, there are many perspectives, and maybe infusing that with other voices and perspectives from the get-go for that context, I think was something that people on the ground felt like was missing. And that some of that reporting on some of those sweeps, like what we showed at the very beginning of the neighborhood sweeps, that they felt like it was reporting on a horse race, like this many undocumented people got picked up last night at the sweep, as opposed to a critical analysis of what is going on here. Is this a good use of public funds? Is this good for public safety? And then there were, on the other side of the spectrum, there was incredible reporting done by journalists over the years. So for example, the East Valley Tribune, a local paper in Maricopa County, won the Pulitzer Prize, I think in 2009, for mm-hmm. a series that they did that was a really hard-hitting series looking at the consequences, really one of the first papers to say there is a racial profiling problem going on here before the courts did. And so I think that really, that this story shows all sides, you know, both the power of journalism to expose and document things that need to be exposed and documented, as well as journalism that enables people in power to go unchecked without really a dialogue or examination. So I think that there are a lot of lessons learned, and I think one answer is making sure the stories have many, many perspectives, and not just criticism from the usual suspects. If there are voices that are not being heard, and perspectives.
Terry, what tips would you offer?
I think this is such a smart audience. They probably already know this, but the main thing I teach my journalism students is that don't just report what a person says, report what they do. And if you can report what they do, then sometimes what they say is more contextualized. And I think all of you probably know that, and probably gravitate to media that does have context in it.
And just finally, we have maybe 1 minute left.
Actually, we have to wrap it up.
Oh, so dear.
It,
I'm going to let you go on a lightning round question. No, I just wanted to just thank you so much. I think you covered really what I was going to ask anyway. Thank you both so much for your years of investment in this story. I remember I've talked to Jude about this, and Terry, it's such a pleasure to meet you. I hope we get to meet you in person at some point. But thank you so much to the Berkeley Public Library for bringing us together. And huge fan of both of the women here and the community at Berkeley for tuning in and tuning into a story that is an American story. It's not an Arizona story. It's definitely an American story. So
absolutely. And I just wanted to say thank you everyone for coming to our program. And thank you to Monica, Jude, and Terry. Please visit berkeleypubliclibrary.org to find out about our other programs and events, and have a great day.
Thank you.